Rock and roll is often associated with excess, and at the end of the 70s, this image was clearly in the air. Even outsiders, the cool young artists of Stiff Records, found themselves lured into its temptations. In the midst of punk's musical revolution in the UK, stripping rock down to its barest essentials and attitudes, a young Elvis Costello stepped into the spotlight with his own ironic take on rock and roll indulgence, Pump It Up. And in doing so, kicked off his own musical revolution, on which would take the form of New Wave and carry across the following decade. Hello there, it's Warren Hewitt here. Hope you're doing marvellously well. Welcome back to another episode in the series. If you haven't already, please subscribe, and if you hit the notification bell, you'll be notified when we have a new video. And if you're into production, you can go to producelikeapro.com and sign up for the email list and get a whole bunch of free goodies. Elvis Costello was born Declan Patrick McManus in Paddington, London in 1954. Music was in his blood, and Costello learned from the example and experience of his jazz trumpeter father. His first broadcast recording was singing backup for his father for a TV commercial. He formed his earliest bands as a young teenager, and in 1976, he signed to the newly formed Stiff Records label. His first single, Less Than Zero, and his first album, My Aim Is True, were both released in 1977. Later that year, he formed his first permanent backing band, The Attractions. Costello has a particular talent for capturing, often with a wry sense of humour, the world around him. When Costello wrote Pump It Up while sitting on top of a fire escape in Newcastle, he was reflecting on the cliché of excess, sex, drugs and rock and roll. Costello was in the midst of Stiff Records' live tour, a package tour of the label's biggest artists and most promising artists. The newly formed record label was known for its clever, offbeat and often sarcastic lineup of musicians like Nick Lowe and Ian Dury and the Blockheads. But even this group of musicians could find themselves drawn into the fantasy of the rock and roll lifestyle. Costello wrote in his autobiography, "All it took was some gin, some tonic, some blue pills and a red pen to write Pump It Up during my first exposure to idiotic rock and roll decadence. I thought myself above and beyond it, but quickly found it easier to indulge than to sit in judgment." The lyrics use double entendres and irony, highlighting the temptations of young celebrity. Costello leaned into the past in writing this record, in particular Bob Dylan's Subterranean Homesick Blues. And of course, Dylan noticed this connection, as Costello recalled in his autobiography. "One night many years later, Bob Dylan said to me, 'You too! How could they do that to you? How could they take your song like that?' It took me a moment to know what he was talking about, and in a moment more to realize that he was putting me on. But then, U2's Get On Your Boots was probably, to Pump It Up, what Subterranean Homesick Blues is to Chuck Berry's Too Much Monkey Business." Pump It Up is, of course, an example of how artists draw on the music of the past to find their own sound. The resemblance to a song more than a decade old at the time doesn't take away from the fact that Pump It Up was, in fact, incredibly modern. Punk was in the midst of a fast-burning musical revolution, and Pump It Up fits right into that moment. In many ways, we hear Pump It Up as the start of New Wave, with this punk attitude mixed with ironic humour and a little cleaner sound. Pump It Up's sound is rough, powerful and outspoken. The fact that it was recorded so quickly also speaks to the punk spirit found in the song. 2 days after writing the song, Costello and the Attractions debuted it in a high school cafeteria. A week later, the song was on tape, recorded in only a few takes at Eden Studios in Acton, London. Fellow Stiff Records artist Nick Lowe produced the track. All the parts were played by Costello and his Attraction bandmates. Bass was Bruce Thomas, organ Steve Naive, and drums Pete Thomas. The guitar part was recorded by Costello. Let's check out the guitar track now. I love this track. When I first heard it as a kid, I saw Costello playing the guitar, so I always assumed it was him. But then as I got more sophisticated and older, I started thinking maybe they had a session player. just because it is a really, really good guitar track. Have a listen to this. Put in the kick and snare. So Elvis's guitar part is simple, but fantastic. There's a bass line that is totally infectious by the wonderful Mr. Bruce Thomas. And that line is. And over that intro bass line, Elvis does this. And then this little blues bend where he never quite goes from the minor third to the major third, but just a little. So once again, and then this climb up, which everybody's doing. What I love about this is he does the Pete Townshend pretty much every time he plays this next three chord riff. And then he does this dead string part while Bruce is playing that. Which you'll notice on the bass line is totally blues. It's completely blues because it's got the minor third to the major third. So you've got that. So I love, even in punk rock and new wave, there's always a bit of blues in there. Minor third major. Great. So under that bass line, really subdued, Elvis is just chugging along. Until he gets to the pump it up where it's just the E. Great, energetic, cool guitar part. It's interesting, the guitar part is definitely punk. I remember reading about Steve Jones, for instance, when they were tracking the Sex Pistols album. I don't say first album, but Sex Pistols album. And some session players tried to play like that. And I realized as I got older that to play like Elvis Costello, to play like this is completely unique. It is punk rock in attitude, but with the singer that can write some of the greatest songs of all time. So it's a really interesting combination of the right attitude, the right spirit, but with incredible songwriting by possibly one of the greatest songwriters that ever lived. Unlike the kind of straight eighth note bass lines of much of punk, or ones that simply just follow the guitar lines, Bruce Thomas's bass line carries an infectious groove. What a great bass line. What a great idea for a verse. And you hear a bit of that subterranean homesick blues going on there. But a funky, cool, groovy bass line that just helps it drive along with Pete Thomas's incredible drums, of course. To me, though, the organ part is another element that separates it from punk, more of a new wave color, not just guitars and drums. always loved about this part is that sort of Vox Continental organ sound is so 60s. And I remember reading about the Attractions, and actually Pete confirming this, that the way they would dress was just 60s kind of Beatle clothes that were 10 years too late, that you could go and pick up in thrift stores, in Oxfam, for those of you from the UK, those Oxfam stores, and just pick them up cheap. So you had all these guys dressed in New Wave with the skinny ties, the kind of Beatley ties, and the little skinny tight suits, and the little granddad collars kind of shirts. It was pretty much what happened in the 90s in America with the sort of Beastie Boys look of wearing 70s clothes. They were just going back and they were buying these clothes. And here it is in the music. You've got a Vox Continental and a piano. I mean, that's so 60s. I love it. Put in the guitar. Everybody's playing that line. Listen to the bass, the piano, the guitar. Put in the drums. Key line against the bass, with Elvis just... backgrounds, bounces into the keys tracks. Doesn't get any better. Just what a high energy track. So, there's nobody better to describe the drum track than the drummer. Pete Thomas, his drum track, again, is so 60s influence. Pete is a huge fan of classic drummers from the 60s. None more so than Ringo Starr, Charlie Watts, and of course, Keith Moon.
So we're going for that new wave, pump it up, this year's girl sound. So you start with two opposite lugs. And then bring up a third lug. There we go. Needs to come down. That's kind of it. That's the and then the biscuit tin snare, the Ludwig Supraphonic, without much dampening. When we recorded Pump It Up, this is how I played it. I don't quite play it like this anymore, but this is how the original part was played.
Fantastic.
Yeah, Pump It Up was a great one. That was done at Eden Studios, just up the road from the Swan Pub, where we went quite a lot. And one morning, Elvis just came in. He was in a really good mood. He just got out of the cab. He came in. He just played it to us. I think he'd sort of had it for a while, but he just worked on it the night before or in the cab coming to the studio, whatever it was. And he just played it to us. And you know, you sort of know it's a great one. And there's a section in the middle where there's a breakdown. Well, there is now, and which I think I might have suggested because it reminded me of Satisfaction, you know, by the Stones. And, you know, that's got the famous da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da- so we put a breakdown in the middle in a similar sort of way. Anyway, I'll play a bit of Pump It Up and see if the drums fit. We'll be right back.
Amazing.
So there you are, Pump It Up on the original, the same drums with the same tuning many years later, 44 years later. Pump It Up, I'm pretty sure, was a first take. Like I said, he came in, he played it to us. And you know, when you play a great song, when someone comes in with a great song, they sort of play themselves. You know, that's kind of what I found over the years, which is probably why the Beatles were so great, because it's just, all he had to do was play it, you know. I can't remember anything about Nick particularly on that day. I'm sure he probably went, that's the one, don't touch a thing, come and hear it. That used to be the call, was come in and hear it. And you know, there would always be a case of Blue Nun, Lieberfrau Milk, revolting. And we would get through a case of it every day, probably. I don't know why, that was just the, we all thought it was really great, you know, like Blue Nun. So that probably helped, you know, and then we'd all go down the pub, down to the Swan, and you know, we didn't think too much about it really. It's just, it just seemed like that's how life should be, you know, just come in the studio and make fantastic records.
Now, was it pretty much everything live off the floor? Was there any overdubs?
I can't remember. There might be, but nothing much. You know, I'm sure the vocal was probably live. No, that's just how you did it, you know. I don't know. Elvis has got a better memory than me. He'll probably remember exactly what happened.
So last but no means least, let's talk about Elvis's incredible vocal. I've been on tiddlehooks, adding in dirty looks, listen to the music, thinking about this and that. She said, that's that. I don't want to chitter chat. Turn it down a little bit or turn it down flat. Pump it up when you don't really need it. Pump it up until you can feel it. Great. Yeah, it's, you know, again, you hear the subterranean homesick blues kind of like push on the vocal. But it's more of a homage than anything else. And I never really thought about it. Because when you first hear the song, it's punk. It's a birth of new wave in many, many ways. It's got a punk attitude with the keys and with the obvious kind of 60s influence. Because new wave seemed to harp back to great songwriting. You think of Elvis Costello, you think of Squeeze, you think of these bands that wrote incredible songs that could have been 60s pop songs, could have been Beatles songs. I mean, it's no accident that Elvis Costello and Paul McCartney have worked together. You know, there's a definite meeting of incredible spirits there, just wonderful songwriting. Down in the pleasure center, hell bent or heaven sent, listen to the propaganda, listen to the latest slander. There's nothing under heaven she wouldn't understand. Pump it up until you can feel it. Pump it up when you don't really need it. Such an incredible vocal. For me, Elvis has so much personality in his voice. In modern times, we talk about pitch and timing, and everybody adjusts pitch and timing. You can do that all day if you like, but what you can't get is that much attitude, and more importantly, character, charisma. When I first saw the kind of Buddy Holly glasses and the 60s kind of Beatle, and he's just kind of standing there, all kind of angular, I mean, it doesn't get any cooler. I'm a little kid looking at it going, who is this guy? I want to be this guy. And I'm sure half of the youth of the UK felt exactly the same way. Pump It Up was released by Stiff Records on June the 10th, 1978. It hit number 24 on the UK singles charts and number 55 in Australia. It's punk guitar and drum sound mixed with a grooving bass line, organ and wit reveals the song to be one of the true predecessors to the new wave sound, which would emerge shortly after in the wake of punk, a movement in which Costello would undoubtedly reign as one of the most important leaders. The song remains one of Costello's most popular songs, still in the ears and minds of new generations of musicians. In fact, just in 2021, listeners were quick to point out that Olivia Rodrigo's hit Brutal draws on Costello's Pump It Up inspirationally, to which Costello famously replied, "That is fine by me, it's how rock and roll works. You take the broken pieces of another thrill and make it into a brand new toy. That's what I did." So as I've said, peppered through this combination of classic 60s style songwriting, punk attitude, instruments that weren't just guitar, bass and drums, the fact that Pete is playing a heavily 60s influenced drum part, the way the band dressed with those kind of, you know, 60s suits, the Buddy Holly glasses, the songwriting, the attitude. I mean, there was a reason why, when I was a little kid, he was a darling, and the band, these guys, Elvis Costello and the Attractions, were the darlings of the British press, music press. We loved it. We absolutely loved it. It was like the combination of everything you wanted. And for me, I'm a bit of a musical snob in some ways. What do I mean by that? I mean, I want it all. I want attitude, I want songwriting, and I want something I can sing along with, but I also want it to be new and fresh, and this was. And what's interesting is it's borrowing from the past and taking from the present and putting it together. Elvis Costello has, well, was then and continues to be one of the greatest songwriters that ever lived. He's inarguably one of the most influential songwriters that ever lived, especially amongst musicians. Not only does he have commercial success, of which he's had great commercial success, Elvis and the Attractions are a very successful band, but Elvis is one of those guys when you're in a writing session or you're tracking a song that comes up all the time. Often we talk about artists that have changed music, and people often debate me, well, they didn't sell many records, so I don't think they were that influential. Well, Elvis, Costello and the Attractions sold records, and they were really influential. There's bands like the Velvet Underground, there's bands like Noi, there's bands like Joy Division, there's the Stooges. There are so many artists, blues artists, that didn't sell as many records that are influential. Elvis did both. He's a very successful artist with an incredible band, and I can't say much more than Elvis Costello, incredible songwriter, amazing band in the Attractions. And for me, this really is the birthplace of New Wave. Thanks ever so much for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. Please leave a bunch of comments and questions below. Tell us what other artists, what other songs you'd like us to feature. So long, farewell, au wiedersehen, au revoir, adios, ciao, tut ziens, auf wiedersehen, tschüss, goodbye.